So you got a book outline?
No.
Wrong. You're formulating one. Okay?
I haven't. I mean, this is all happening so fast. I Googled Somalia Press, found Fadale's name, and sent out a blind email. I had no idea this was going to blow up. None.
Bahadur, you got a book outline?
No, that's what I'm trying to
tell. Stop! Try again. You got a book outline?
I'm formulating it.
I knew you'd get it on the third try. Come on, let's go. Thank you. What else don't you understand? I need to know that.
Ourselves a treat. So you're not afraid to show your powers?
Powers? What powers? What are you talking about? Is there something strange here?
You, a kleptomaniac, get to break into the Pentagon.
I'm holding your neck so you don't get whiplash.
What?
Whiplash. Wanna see this bad bitch level up.
I'm sorry, but it's silly to me now that you had really no idea who the fuck that you were dealing with. I'm like the second coming year, the faucet running on my genius. I was thinking you were way too busy stealing it. So if you're feeling stupid, pay attention, I'll repeat it. Did I mention every day I slay, but I don't get conceited? When I look in the mirror, I see my soul, we have agreed to be the realest, and I put that shit on everything. Burning, 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 thinking I found my purpose. Make this shit hot like furnace. Shut the fuck up, keep learning. Bitch, I've been working on myself. You can't come for the new me, wow. Bitch, wanna get like this, you got to keep. Moving. You know me, you know I'm carefree, might switch it up. Living in 5D, bitch, kick it up. When I rise like Phoenix, they don't know what's happening. You know me, you know I'm carefree, might cut you off. Wanna see this bad bitch level up. When I rise like Phoenix, cut through shit like laser beam. Keep up. Ooh, but don't make me snap. Don't make me show you how I move. When this shit gets bad, you know I'm always listening, learning, making amends. I'm on a mission, making friends, no competition. I'm a smart and I just let them win. I can't avoid the lesson, can't go back to where I've been. There's something new and better on the flip side if you let it in. I'm too empathetic, I don't regret it, I'm resilient. Rip my shit on some wax again, take it
out. Wow. Must have done something pretty serious.
What'd you do, man? What'd you do? What'd you do? Why'd they have you in there?
For killing the president.
To keep it moving.
I mean, I still live in my mom's basement, but you know,
I'm a total loser.
Hey, slow down. Safety first.
Quicksilver's a great character. He's really fun to play, and he has a really fun superpower. Just with the way they decided to shoot it, you know, everybody's stopped and he's going normal speed. So it's Quicksilver time is what we've been calling it. It's also interesting is when he's in everybody else's time, you know, like when he's in the real world time. He's kind of odd. Can be really, really taxing for him. I think he can get bored very easily. And also as amazing is that there's a lot of humanity in it and a lot of things that people can relate to. And you know, I get emotional about some of the things in this story because it's, you know, it hits close to home a little bit, you know. It's like there's things in there that are difficult, you know.
Why do you care so much? You see a speech on TV or something?
Yeah, but, he's my father.
What?
Him and my mom, they did.
No, I know, but are you sure?
Yeah. He left my mom before I was born. I met him 10 years back, but I didn't know it was him. By the time I figured it out, it was too late. Then this week I saw him on TV again, and I came to that house looking for him. But by the time I got there, late again. You know, for a guy who was as fast as me, I always seem to be too late.
Let's hope not this time.
That's the thing, is that you can't do this alone. Mutants alone are nothing, but mutants together, you form the X-Men, and you can defeat together, the film is really about family and togetherness and sort of hanging on to that and using that to defeat hate, and to defeat negativity, and there is hope.
Oh, this is, I've been excited to see this scene.
Look at the lamp on his head. Like, what is he doing right now? He's got plastic gloves on his hands and a lamp on his head.
Yeah, I would see
I would see him like playing with things, whatever, and I'm like, go that direction. Yeah, it's like his instincts are really nice. You just wind him up and just let him go. I enjoyed working with this kid. Right? What are we always? I'm always calling him a kid. He's a grown ass man. He's playing a kid, so I believe he's a kid.
No big deal.
No big deal. Are you kidding me? The man put you on the rack. He tested you, and you passed with flying colors, man. Oh! Ass kick, you go crush your next martial arts madness.
This scene is such a crowd.
I love
pleaser.
That moment right there. He's this kid. Someday he's going to be a comedic genius. Evan Peters, everybody.
Someday. I believe he is.
Yeah. No, but you know what I'm saying. Yeah, he's going to be carrying his own movies as a lead comedic actor.
He's got a lot of stuff going on because, you know, I always love Max in your script, Chris, but the big concern I had with the character was that the audience would be laughing at him, and given he's your entire motivation for going to the beatdown at the end of the film, you really got to care about him.
Right.
And he can't just be a clown, someone you're laughing at. You gotta love him.
Mm-hmm. And he's got that naturally, though. He is a bit of a clown as a person, but then he's got this other side to him, and you just can't help but like the kid.
Yeah,
you know.
And when, you know,
he was the first one cast, wasn't he?
He was the first one cast. He came in and he read for us. And he came in, and I liked him, but he was so, I don't know what was going on, but he just wasn't on he didn't have the lines down perfectly, but I liked him so much, I said, dude, I love you, come back and do it again. He came back, he did it again, and he nailed it. In fact, when I would get down, because I was looking for you, and I couldn't find you, I would just keep watching Evan's audition again and again.
I'm gonna find him.
And I would laugh
Channel.
My butt off. Yeah. And this whole thing about the valetudo and all that stuff, he just nailed and really, really killed it.
Yeah, there was many a take that I had, especially in this, I had such a hard time not busting out in laughter sitting opposite him because he was, you know, he'd give me that look and be so sincere with everything he's saying. It was everything within me to keep from breaking up.
He was really nervous, wasn't he? You told me.
He was nervous, but he was killing me.
It was his first scene. It was the first day he worked. I think it was like day 3 or 4 of the schedule. This scene plays so well, even though you know exactly what's coming.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a question of how. And I think it's real testament to both Cam and Evan that they play it so well. I mean, you know, you don't feel like Max is an idiot. I mean, you're not like, get out of there. You can see that he's, you know, he thinks that the popular guy is being nice to him, and he's kind of going for it.
Mm-hmm. Great little comic bit
he's
right
still
there.
A little Kung Fu Hustle.
Yeah, I love that. Isn't that funny?
The snake.
There you go. No kidding around now, though.
When you get tagged, your mind only registers two thoughts. Back the hell up or get the hell in. Dude, I don't have any gear on. It's what it comes down to. You're either backing out or you're getting in.
Yeah, we rehearsed the fight scenes, but most of them were just me getting my ass kicked. It was the sidekick, you know, the kind of guy who he videotaped everything and I couldn't fight. So it's like, it's kind of this like wannabe kind of guy, which felt like me.
Look at these fucks.
I know.
You should just rev up and put them out of their misery.
Yo, I heard you got the scholarship to Kentucky. Dad must be pretty stoked.
Yeah.
Big game Sunday, huh?
Yeah.
Won't you have practice in like a few hours? I was just asking.
So. What are you, a fucking spy?
I just
get out of here.
All right, man. Sorry.
What the fuck?
You say you can't make art. You're happy.
Well, and I'd say you're in good shape.
Warren's the kind of the trickster or like the shaman of the group.
He is going to the University of Kentucky under a soccer scholarship. He's kind of following his father's footsteps, but also sort of seeing that he doesn't quite want to be his father and isn't feeling this is the life that he wanted and doesn't feel like he's doing anything special or exciting with his life. So I think he feels a little numb and depressed and wants to do something. And his friend Spencer comes to him and tells him that there's this special collections section of his library at Transy University that is basically unguarded. And it gives him this harebrained idea that maybe he could steal them and then sell them.
Warren, there's no secret knock.
Yeah, well, there should be.
Which?
Don't cancel me.
What the fuck are you doing here?
I need to talk to you. But not here.
It's the declaration of fraud.
We have to go.
To Holland?
To the Netherlands.
Can you stop?
No, I'm not stopping until it's burned.
Warren.
It's evidence. Motherfuck. Thank you. Sorry.
So, you want to go all the way over there to meet some actual criminals you know nothing about, to talk about something we don't even have?
Yes. What's your suggestion?
So this is how you remember it?
Not exactly. But if this is how Spencer remembers it, then let's go with it. Friend
of mine. You know, I didn't know if this whole going back and forth between the real people and us was going to work. You listen to Warren's tapes and you talk with him a little bit and you hear what his side of the story is, and then you listen to Eric and Jazz and Spencer and you get a feel for each person's side of the story, and there's definitely all similar things, but there's definitely some stuff that's a little different. It's not based on a true story, it is a true story, and you hear it right from their mouths, which makes it that much more affecting.
Talked to Warren a little bit and wanted to get in his head and figure out why he did it, what he was going through, and he sort of explained it as much as he could without sort of getting in my head and making me sort of play him. I'm from the Midwest in the suburbs, and I think I just really wanted to do something different than that. I didn't want to go take all the steps, and I think that was sort of something that me and Warren had in common, the real Warren. And then there's this sort of existential crisis about why we're doing all this and what it's all about.
I'm done. I can't see it ending well. I just can't go back in there.
Okay, well, just, look, today was bad luck, but we got a trial run, okay? Now we can make adjustments and...
What could happen, like, if it goes wrong, our futures?
Which fucking future are you worried about? The one that's fucking indistinguishable from everyone else's? Where you fucking beaver away to get the shit you're told you need to have by some fucking asshole who's gonna tell you what a great big success you are once you get it all? Spence, you are the one who wanted to fucking change. You started this whole thing, remember? Time seems to be over. Huh?
Yeah, I do. Right. I think we should just quit while we're ahead.
Dude, this isn't fucking ahead.
Man, I don't want you waking up 10 years from now wondering what could have happened and who you could have been.
You're told that you're going to have this life. You're told that you're special, and yet you feel like you're kind of doing what everybody else is doing. I think they wanted to do something special. They wanted to do something different, and they kind of wanted to do it in an easy, quick way and not really work for it.
You ever wonder, he ended up being born you here and not someone else?
Maple Street, USA. Late summer. A tree-lined little world of front porch gliders, barbecues, the laughter of children, and the bell of an ice cream vendor. At the sound of the roar and the flash of light, it will be precisely 6:43 p.m. on Maple Street. In the last calm and reflective moment before the monsters came.
It's an odd deal, I know. Odd checking procedures. Though not a patch on what you put your victims through.
Sister, I didn't kill anybody.
The courts have given you over to my care. Not for correction, but for storage while they weigh your fate. This is not a meat locker. Here you will repent for your crimes to the only judge that matters, the Almighty God.
There is no God. Not a God who would create the things I saw.
Yes, Starry, my little green men. Nah, that won't do here.
They weren't human. They were monsters.
All monsters are human.
The world is a filthy place. It's a filthy goddamn horror show.
I wanted to see you. Are you feeling any better? Are the visits with the good doctor helping you?
Yeah. Turns out I ate my mother. So that's your diagnosis? I'm a psychopath?
Yep, and the worst kind. You're charismatic and compelling and a pathological liar.
I used to think you were like me. You were attracted to the darkness. But Tate, you are the darkness.
No.
I'm saying go away.
What? No. Don't do this.
Go away, Tate.
You're all I want. You're all I have.
Go away. No!
Still my beautiful boy. We're together again.
Yeah!
Kyle!
From where I'm sitting, you got the world on a string. So you go home to your mansion on the hill and you thank God for all you got. You scram.
If the killer who stalks this town is not soon caught, people will seek out scapegoats, and your kind have always proven convenient sacrifices in such instances.
Excuse me. Is there any place else you can eat? You're upsetting my daughter.
See what you did? You give these folks a free show, who's gonna wanna buy tickets? Come on, you stupid freaks, let's go.
Hey, stop calling us freaks! We're people, just like everybody in this joint. We sentence you and your whole rotten world to death. Look at us. We will always win because we will always defend each other to the death. You want to know why? Because we have no one else to turn to.
I know who you are. I always know. Hell. Just the way Ma hates you tells me everything I need to know. But I got proof. I asked some of the old-timers, the ones that have been around since Methuselah was a kid. They told me about your dad and your brothers. The famous Toledo Lobster Clan. I don't know why you don't caught them. You gave me these. But I want to hear you say it. You're my father. Say it. Tell me. Come on, say it, Dad. You're my dad. Please, come on, answer me. Come on. Come on.
Yes.
You know, in your black heart of hearts, you know, you're just like me. Might I suggest that when you murder him, you do so off the property? It'd be damned awkward to keep running into him for all eternity.
And what makes you think I mean to do him harm?
I'm dead, dear, not stupid. This is my problem with police officers.
All you care about is evidence. Evidence, evidence, evidence. Until that evidence no longer fits the narrative you need to be true. At which point the evidence becomes an illusion, a mistake, a trick. Greatness is about vision. And you have made yourself blind to everything but what your eyes can see. My father was a true believer. Ate the little cracker and drank the wine every Sunday. And he was the meanest son of a bitch you've ever seen. Kill a cat for purring too loud. You want me to tell you the worst thing in this world? Religion.
You can kill thousands. Millions. But you will never find peace.
Well, then. I guess I'm just going to have to kill God. The art never judges. I envy it. Life in two dimensions. Frozen in forever beauty. To watch the world go by unencumbered by the gossip and pain of three-dimensional men. Do not judge me. This is as far as I care to take you. The living cling to life above all. But the trophy misprized is to die. In peace.
What are you doing?
The government sent a warning. Missiles are coming.
Order on the outside does wonders to keep the chaos safely on the inside.
You've created your own rules in here. I understand why. I'm sure it was impossible to resist the temptation of making this place over in your image. Especially when you thought that no one who knew any better would ever be around to notice.
So how's this work?
I'm not going to tell you what criteria I'm using to grade you. Things you may feel are helpful may be hurtful. Things you may feel will compel rejection may be exactly what I'm looking for.
Tell me about your anger. Tell me about your grandmother. Tell me who you really are.
You have lived!
I haven't. Oh, yes, you have. You have crammed 10 lifetimes of failures and screw-ups into your 30 years. When your grandfather rejected you because of your perverted lifestyle, I took you in. I deserve to live. One lifetime of me is worth 50 of yours.
The only thing I ever wanted from you was for you to love me and accept me. Why couldn't you just give me that?
Sorry, darling. It's just not in my nature.
Tender love is blind. It requires a dedication. All is love we feel. Needs no conversation. We ride it together, making love with each other,
I was just making conversation to put myself at ease.
What are these?
They don't have a name. Funny how we found a pill to help artists and writers, but none of us have ever given it a name. I used to be like you. I thought small, I wrote small. Little plays about little things that made little money and attracted little attention. I had a friend, though. He writes for television, you know the name. Disgustingly prolific, silly rich. Couldn't write a thank you note without someone handing him a trophy of some kind. And I thought to myself, how is he doing it?
He invited me out here one winter, and when I arrived, he handed me one of those.
Murdering human beings to drink their blood?
We're not dining on doctors, or eating up engineers, or snacking on scientists. We find the ones who won't be missed. The ones who are drained on society. It's basically a community service.
You chose to be a writer. Because you don't really live in this world. You observe it. You interpret it. You feed off of it. And then you sit and you put words together so that the poor suckers who do live in the world can see what they look like, who they are.
With American Horror Story, it's the logic of dreams, which is not necessarily logic, but there's a kind of emotional logic.
When my kids were younger, I would make them watch The Twilight Zones every Thanksgiving because they showed them all.
Nice.
And this show, seriously, that first season is one episode of The Twilight Zone spanned over the whole season.
Yeah.
This show, ask people what they're really afraid of, you know? Show it to them, see how they react.
In the 50s and 60s, the horror of our culture in its relationship with women, gays, ill people was pretty damn wacky.
Being at the mercy of other people's opinions about your state of being is really terrifying, I think. It's how close it is, I think, to possibility that makes it more terrifying.
I do hope that we've been able to highlight in our own way the evils of racism, the stupidity of racism.
It's not what is a freak, what is normal.
What we have found to be freaky is the lack of compassion in others, the darkness in their heart, and the lengths they will go to destroy another human being.
The shooting scene itself, I mean, I obviously wouldn't know, but I truly thought it was very much how it would be. I thought it was underplayed in a way that it was more intense.
The way that they shot it was really interesting. The fact that you don't see Tate until the very end, that reveal is so much more poignant.
Please!
I remember Ryan told me I was going to be doing Andy Warhol, and that was like a few weeks before we were going to actually shoot it. I was panicked, like, okay, I have to watch everything, I have to listen to everything, I have to figure out how he moves, how he talks, how he walks, like what he was going through. And they saw it, and they saw the dailies, and they were like, oh, okay, cool, now we want you to play Manson. You know, you see it, and it's like 30 seconds. But it was like, you know, months of trying to figure out.
And you don't really have a choice, and we're shooting Monday, and you have to just go and do it. And you're like, oh my God, I have to do that. I was sort of shocked that I walked away alive.
You played cult leader Kai Anderson on American Horror Story Cult.
It's such a complex character, you know, there's like the seductive side and then the crazy side and the manic side and the evil side. It was a lot thinking about taking that all on.
How challenging is it for you as an actor to try to ground him in reality? Because it's so much scarier knowing that this could be happening down the street. I mean, this guy could be living next door to me.
It was one of the things that I thought was very scary about this season is that it was already grounded in reality. If somebody like Kai, who, you know, you can see in news clips, who you can see all over the internet and all over the media. I read books. I read Combating Cult Mind Control. And then I read Seductive Poison, which was a story about the Jonestown survivor story, which was fascinating to hear her story because she lived through all of it and was indoctrinated and then was being sleep deprived and being isolated and fed false information and I'm right, everyone else in the world is wrong. And it was all kind of under the guise of we're creating this community, you know, this community where everybody can be welcome. You know, people of all races and ages, and kind of, you know, in theory, it was a great thing. But then obviously underneath, there was so much violence and horribleness that was going on. So I just tried to immerse myself as much as I could into all those characters because they were real people. And I felt like it was important to try to, even though it was sort of Kai's insanity and him telling this story and him kind of living it through his own eyes, I still thought it would be the best thing to do to make it as real as possible so that it could be affecting and so that people could learn these horrible traps that you can get in with cults and then you just believe everything that they're saying and what they're doing. The fantastical stuff is scary in your imagination, but I think when it really hits home and it's really in the world out there, then that's when it becomes really terrifying.
Hello, ma'am. Miss?
I never know what's right. Everything seems to offend nowadays.
I recognize you from television. Yeah. You're that asshole who threw a latte on my wife and me. Isn't that right?
Was that you? I'm so sorry. Okay, I'm Mr. Clumsy, you know, just Mr. Butterfingers.
I don't think it was an accident.
I'm sure you made a mistake or two in your life you'd want to be forgiven for.
What do you want?
I'm running for city council. My hope is that I can get elected and be known and remembered as the man who made a real difference in this town rather than the one who was savagely beaten and humiliated or who accidentally spilled my latte on you. You see, you need to give a humiliated man some way to redeem himself in his own eyes or else he's at risk to be drawn into darkness. Like Germany after World War I. May I come in and speak to you about some of my ideas?
No. No, you cannot.
When was the last time you felt really safe? Like, can you remember when you weren't scared all the time?
I'm sorry. What does that have to do with you running for city council?
Did you know that you are 40% more likely to be the victim of a violent crime committed at the hands of an illegal immigrant, and that the murder and rape rates are the highest they've ever been?
That's not true. Those numbers don't seem right to me. Where are you getting your information from?
Facebook.
Facebook. Okay, well, you might want to recheck the veracity.
There are no political parties anymore, ma'am. It's just Miss. It's just them and you and the people like me who are willing to stand between you.
I am interested in reaching out to people, making contact with other human beings, building bridges, not walls.
What's that behind your back? This door is new. Strong. Why would you need a strong door like this? Bars in the windows. Why would you need a knife to answer the door? Are you gonna melt all this metal down and build a bridge?
I'm gonna need you to leave now.
It's so hot out here. Can I come in for a glass of water, please?
No, you cannot.
Can I use your phone? My car broke down. Pretty please?
I'm gonna need you to get off my property.
Can I use your restroom? Can't you see I'm an injured man? Aren't I a vulnerable class now?
I am going to call the police!
Easy. Until it's you they're coming for.
I have a question for Miss Mayfair Richards.
Can we get your name, sir?
I'm Councilman Kai Anderson.
My question is this. Did you ever think you were more than just kindling? You're not the flame. You're the spark to start the fire that I built. You're not a hero. You're a symbol. One I created. Killing people doesn't get the men hard and the ladies wet anymore. But Americans lose their ever-loving shit when you destroy their symbols. Statues, flags, pledges of allegiance, $20 bills, white Jesus, and Merry fucking Christmas. You come for any of that stuff, you got rioting in the streets and domination of the news cycle for weeks. You symbolize the hope that women will one day win an argument with their husbands, that they won't be catcalled when they walk down the streets, that their bosses won't talk about their tits anymore, that they'll make just as much money as men make, that the fight is winnable. When I kill you, they'll see that there is no hope.
The tools of conquest do not necessarily come with bombs and explosions and fallout. There are weapons that are simply thoughts, attitudes, prejudices, to be found only in the minds of men. For the record, prejudices can kill, and suspicion can destroy, and a thoughtless, frightened search for a scapegoat has a fallout all of its own. For the children, and the children yet unborn. And the pity of it is that these things cannot be confined to the Twilight Zone.
The
Sorry, Mr. Shepard. One of the other seniors tried to clip at him. And then the boys got into some beer.
Okay, well, thanks for getting him home.
Sure.
I'll take this from here.
See you, Adam.
Bye, Ricky.
Thanks, Ricky.
Mm-hmm. Looks like I'm in trouble. Call the police.
I don't think it's time for the police quite yet. Looks like you could use a shower, though.
Call the shower police.
Okay, how about a bath?
One. Adam 12. We got a dirty kid here and needs a bath. Over.
One Adam 12. Very nice. All right, come on. Can you walk here?
It's all good, Daddy-O.
Uh-huh.
I can walk. Crawl.
There you go.
Run.
In case you slide down, I'll just hang out.
A fam and a bass together? Sings together.
Something like that.
I never take a bath. It's always a shower. I think I like a bath, hmm? I enjoy bathing, Father.
Is that right?
Yes, Father. One does enjoy a pleasant bathing experience. Don't you agree? Am I in trouble?
I don't know yet. How do you like drinking?
Oh, great. Drinking is great. See, now I can drink together like two old guys.
Yeah, that's not gonna happen.
Well, drink by myself. That's fun too, isn't it?
No. No, it isn't. Not really.
Alright. It's kind of fun. It makes you feel... nothing. Oh, but then it makes you sad, doesn't it? I don't know. Maybe I just gotta get used to it. Gotta get more practice. Well, wait a minute. You're the expert around here, Dad. Why do you like drinking?
I don't.
Don't fool me.
I know. But it's time to stop.
Don't say that if you don't mean it.
We are here to talk about the scene in the bar with Mare and a very drunk Zabel.
It's the first time we see a deeper side of Zabel, where he opens up in a way outside of just details of the case, procedural elements and conversations he has with Mare about the case itself.
Zabel was scripted as being much more confident and flirtatious with Mare. And actually, Evan was... he was just brilliant. He said, this doesn't fit. It doesn't feel right. I don't think Zabel has enough confidence to really, you know, put himself out there and kind of woo this woman.
It started out with a Kiss song playing and I was singing along to that with my friends and shooting pool. And I do this like amazing trick shot. And like, I was, you know, working with a pool professional and trying to learn all these shots. And then, and then Craig was just like, I don't know if we should. And I was like, it doesn't really match our guy.
The wheels have come off. He's had way too much to drink, can't control himself, is loose of tongue, and talks about his past in this very fragile, vulnerable way.
Evan's performance, I very quickly saw, like, this is what it's really like being drunk and sort of lost, that I think we've all had in our life at one point or another. Somehow he knew exactly kind of like how to ring that bell, you know, over and over again in a movie set in a way that I was just really impressed with his skill as an actor.
Really an opportunity to show that there was something off about this guy. You know, he didn't have everything together. He was a little bit floundering and drinking to sort of block some stuff out.
But just some of the lines he came up with on his own, the bagel line was Evan's line, which I think is one of the most memorable lines in the series, really, where, you know, we had written in the script, I woke up one morning and she said, nope, not in love with you. But then Evan added, oh, wait, what? Let me put my bagel down. It added that detail that took it from being, it's a decent line, into something really memorable.
Even in the most tragic, messed up, crazy moments, there's at least, you know, something funny will happen.
God, love Evan. He was so nervous.
I think he was so in his character and so kind of like in the moment that I don't think he was able to be metering that on his own. And so, you know, he came to me and was like hugging me afterwards, being like, I don't think I got it. I think we missed it. And I was like, trust me, we got it. It worked.
And he's like, no, I think we got it. And I'm like, I got to shadow you, man. I'm terrible. I suck. I don't know what's going on here. I can't do it. And I think looking back at it now, it was really me tapping into this feeling of all these missed opportunities, you know, of failing, of missing the mark, of, oh, I didn't get it. And there was an opportunity. And this was such a, I mean, I'm working with Kate Winslet. I was like, oh my God, like this is such a huge opportunity. And I want to do this right.
And I just kept saying to him, just stop all that. It's, you're doing it. Just keep fucking doing it. Go on, go back, do it again. Oh God, okay. He was nailing it, take after take. And it wasn't just that he was nailing it, he was bringing something new and nuanced and different, and he was experimenting, and he just kept going, I suck, right? I definitely suck. And it was quite hard for me because I wanted to just throw my arms around him and, you know, tell him how much I loved him and how brilliant he was being. Evan is a very, very fine, detailed actor, and there's nothing he couldn't do.
So, how was it, the reunion?
It was good. It was, it's pretty awful. Ex was there. Almost ex-wife. She called a lot 2 weeks before the wedding, but we didn't do.
I'm sorry, Zabel. That's sorry.
It's okay. It's safe. Yeah. Hey, here's to peanuts. I still don't know what happened, you know? I woke up one morning and she goes, nope, not in love with you anymore. Okay. Let me put my bagel down. You know what I mean? I'm getting at an age, right? Forgive me, but I'm getting at an age where I'm starting to look at my life and I'm going, well, here's what I thought it would be. And here's what it actually is. Am I making any fucking sense?
What are you?
I'm no one. I want what I'm supposed to want. I wear what I'm supposed to wear, and I work what I'm supposed to work. I stand for nothing. I never fought in a war, and I probably won't ever have to, because the next one's gonna kill us all. I can buy things I can't afford, which means they're never really mine. I don't live, I don't believe, I accumulate. I'm a brand, a middle-class white guy. But you're who you are, even though the price you pay for it is being disinvited from the rest of the world. I'm the one playing dress-up. Is it wrong to want to be with one of the few people in the world who isn't? To have one person in my life who I know is real?
You think of me as a real woman?
You'd be crazy to choose this life if you didn't have to.
How has your, quote, partnership with Ryan Murphy helped you grow and develop as an actor?
Immensely, I think. Like I said, he's given me opportunity after opportunity after opportunity. You don't think you can do all this stuff, and then he sort of throws it at you and says, you can do it. And you're like, well, I don't know if I can do it, but I'm going to do it and see what happens.
I know you're having an affair, but why with this person? Are you a homosexual? I mean, did something happen to you when you were a little kid? Because I'm your wife and I... Somehow, in spite of all of this, I still love you. But I need to know. I mean, was this all a lie?
I don't know. I don't know.
He kind of believes in you with these insane ideas that you never think you would ever be acting or doing. And in that respect, helps you grow immensely and gives you a lot of self-confidence and sort of says, well, you kind of question yourself in a way too. And you're like, well, what do I think I can do? And I could probably do more than that. The character I'm doing now in Pose is exhausting, and especially emotionally and mentally. So I'm done.
It sounds like you're due for...
Super done.
Due for someone who's just being...
Yeah, dude, I just want to be.
No wonder.
I just want to relax and be. That'd be great.